So we'll just start with hellos. There'll be a few more people drifting in. This is Tom Hagel, who is the Professor Emeritus at UD School of Law. And he's come to talk to us about the Constitution, among other things, and how it helps us frame our legal system and citizens' rights. So I think it would be helpful if people go around and just give your name and say whether you're on the committee, because we have a few new committee people who haven't been here recently. Al, you want to start?
I'm Al Schleter. I'm an alternate member of Justice Force.
I'm Jennifer Bergman. I'm on the committee.
Hello, I'm Steve McQueen. I apologize for my lateness. I'm also a member of the on the committee of the Justice System Task Force.
I'm John Hempfling. I'm also a member of the Justice System Task Force. And Judith Hempfling and Kate Hamilton will not be here tonight.
I'm Mia Stewart, and I'm newly on the committee.
I'm Leona Madison, and I'm also on the committee.
He's on the committee, and let me just say that Ellis is hoping to arrive, but he is in the hospital because a friend of his has passed away, Charlie Krimenberg. So he's with Joyce, and he'll be here. Helen?
I'm Gabe Lee.
Okay, you're here. And?
Patty Bates, Village Manager.
Dave Hale, Chief of Police.
So our committee has a charge from the Village Council, and one piece of that is that we make an effort to engage with the community in terms of education about our legal system and our village justice system. And so this is one of our first attempts to do that. We've invited the community, and we'll probably have a few other people drift in to think about this issue. When, at the rise of this educational session, our committee's gonna hang out a little longer, please, so we can just have some check-ins about where we are and our intentions for next month. So I guess we'll just go ahead and get started. And Tom?
I think it'd be helpful if I gave you some overview of my background so you understand where I'm coming from in this. When I went to law school, there was only two jobs that I wanted, and that was the legal aid lawyer or public defender. This was back in the era of Watergate, and I remember watching the hearings and Barbara Jordan. It just mesmerized me, and I think I owe her the motivation to go to law school. But in any event, back then, some of you old enough to remember, people were very socially active in a lot of areas. So I became a public defender and did that for about 5 years. Then went and got an advanced law degree, and then after that, I got a teaching job at the University of Gate Law School. And I did that for 32 years. And while I was there, my area of specialty was criminal law, criminal procedure, trial work, things like that. Started the criminal law clinic there. And even while I was a professor then, I still did some practice on the side where I would take court appointments for criminal cases. Not that long after I started there, I was appointed as what's known in the statutes in Ohio as an acting judge, meaning that I fill in for the Dayton Municipal Court judges who are sick or on vacation or whatever. And I've been doing that for 26, 27 years. So I've spent a lot of time in the context of the criminal justice system. I thought a lot about a lot of the problems that were alluded to in the vision statement here. So I've got some general ideas, and then I think it's most helpful to open it up to you folks. Because you're obviously a lot more progressive than a lot of other communities, and one of the things you get going for here is you're so small. There are various commissions and committees in Dayton, but it's big enough where you just don't get that the overview of representation. My guess is if I knew all of your backgrounds, you probably each represent a distinct interest group, either by age, income, race, whatever. Too often you don't get that. But anyway, one of the issues I hear is questions about the mayor's court. The Ohio Supreme Court has been trying to get rid of mayor's courts for years, but there's so much political pushback because there's so many people who say they've got a vested interest in keeping it going for various reasons. As you probably know, mayor's courts have limited jurisdiction. They can only deal with so many cases. Quite frankly, any serious case has to go to the municipality that you're under here. I think it's Xenia. So the types of cases that would go to Xenia Municipal Court, some of them could be dealt with in a mayor's court. Now, to show you, I think, the dramatic difference between the two, in a municipal court in a municipality versus a mayor's court, is that if you're charged with DUI, a first-degree misdemeanor, OVI we call it nowadays, you have, if you don't, can't hire your own attorney, you can't afford it, they'll appoint an attorney for you at no cost to you. There will be a prosecutor there who will prepare the case and present it. And obviously a judge who is a graduate of law school and has to have, I think, 6 years of experience before they can even become a judge. So you have that in your regular municipal court, where under mayor's courts, the mayor, it is, I guess, got to be the mayor. And I may be wrong on this, but from information I've picked up, if you are charged with something, you go before the mayor, but there's no prosecutor. If it's a serious, in fact, under U.S. Supreme Court rulings, if you are charged with anything above a minor misdemeanor, you have a right to an appointed attorney if you can't afford one. So let's say you're charged with a second-degree misdemeanor under the Ohio Revised Code and you're before a mayor's court, and think you're innocent and you want to challenge it, well, what are you going to do? They're not going to appoint an attorney for you, from what I understand. You have somebody up there making a judgment about it who may or may not be a lawyer. I don't know if your mayor is or not. You don't have a prosecutor to put a case on. That's one of the reasons why the Supreme Court for the longest time has been trying to get rid of them, because there's a strong question as to whether they do justice. On the other hand, you have mayor's courts that are integral parts of small communities. You don't have mayor's courts in large communities, obviously. There's some good aspects to that. My guess is, and your mayor's been mayor, what, 20 years or something like that, probably knows almost everybody, if not everybody they know, but he probably all knows all the families who've been here for a while. And knows whose kids are whose kids and whatever. And therefore, if, for example, if a kid gets in trouble, goes before the mayor's court, the mayor has almost unlimited discretion in dealing with it. Maybe dealing with it in a way that falls outside of the criminal justice system, which in a lot of cases, that's how it should be. In terms of constitutional protections in that, it raises serious questions as to if somebody challenged it on a constitutional basis, whether they would ever stand. For example, if you're charged with something other than a minor misdemeanor in the mayor's court and you ask for an attorney, let's say you can't afford one, they don't give it to you, that's an easy one. It'll be whatever the finding is going to be reversed in a heartbeat because you have a right to that. So there's pros and cons. Most, that's why there's so few mayor courts anymore. Now, you have a municipal court in Xenia that has jurisdiction over for the cases that aren't handled by the mayor's court. But there's an intermediate solution, and it may be a solution to it. And a lot of people don't even know they exist. You have a municipal court, a regular municipal court like in Xenia. On the other hand, you have a mayor's court. But there's also what's known as a county court. And these are for small communities. In Montgomery County, I think there's three of them, maybe. What they are courts with regular judges. They're elected, like all the other judges are. They have to have minimal requirements, law degree, a certain number of years of legal experience in that. The Public Defender's Office contracts with these small county courts to provide representation, and also all of them have part-time prosecutors. So you have a kind of a mini MINI court there that provides all of the protections you would get in a regular court system without the expense. And I know from, I know the judges in those county courts, and I know the people who work with their prosecutors and defense attorneys, it seems to work out. They sometimes only meet, I think, 2 or 3 times a week. It's very personalized. And again, their jurisdiction is small towns around there, kind of the same thing you have here. So in my mind, you have the best of both worlds in a county court. Now, the next question is, so what? Well, keep in mind that all municipal courts and mayor's courts are creations of the state legislature. It's Title 19, it's a long set of statutes that talk about the various levels of courts, and there's a long, long, long statute where it gives you precisely when the municipal courts in each municipality in the entire state of Ohio were created. It goes on for pages. Point being is the legislature could authorize the existence of a county court in this jurisdiction, which would, I think, address a lot of what I've heard are the problems that, or the concerns that a lot of people have about lack of professionalism, respect for the rights of defendants, and that. I mean, I can't imagine being charged with a crime where I could go to jail, and I don't have a right to an attorney, and do they have a prosecutor in these courts?
I don't know.
No.
So the mayor just decides all this on their own?
I think so, but I don't know.
Okay. Essentially, yes, but you do have the right then to appeal. I mean, like, sure. It would be as though the trial never occurred. You just
you have the right to appeal.
If you get sent to the mayor's court, I think you can basically just send yourself on to the municipal court.
Wouldn't it be nice to get it right the first time?
I mean, like, from the defendant's, I mean, assuming that the defendant has enough time to, like, play around in courts, I guess from their perspective, you might think that they might see it as having an extra bite at the apple, that if they aren't acquitted.
They get to roll the dice again?
Yeah.
It could be. That's, I suppose, from a defense point of view, would be one way of looking at it. It's kind of scary to think of a justice system where they say, we know it's screwed up, but if we screw up more, you can appeal it, versus let's do it right the first time. If you know this community is serious enough about it, there's some consensus, what I would suggest you do is get a hold of your state representatives and sit down with them and see what they think and what they can do for it, because again, they're all creations of the legislature. Also, there are some people say, well, you know, it's, if we have a small tax base, how are we going to support it in that? Well, so much of the court systems are supported by funds on state and county level. For example, when I sit as an acting judge, I get 2 paychecks for each day that I sit. One of them from the city and one of them from the county, and both of them are getting a certain amount of money each year from the state of Ohio. So it's not like the burden, the financial burden, would fall totally on you folks. But if you have these concerns about a mayor's courts, that's one option I can think of, is getting hold of your representatives and sit down and talk to them about it.
Well, let's assume that it's working as opposed to not working.
Yeah. Well, no. I'm saying if there is a consensus that they want to replace mayor's court or whatever, fine. Because it has to be all or nothing. If they create a county court, mayor's court goes away.
Yeah. Well, if I can just, my perspective is the mayor's court has been working extremely well. The concern is more that there aren't the recently there have not been as many cases sent to it, and so it is sort of dying by this disuse. And so that's something that we will talk about in this committee, but I'm not sure that that we wouldn't be better to support the mayor's court, because my perspective from doing this committee a long time, I can't remember any controversy where that it didn't do its job.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I'm throwing this out as an option. Yeah. If you have a consensus, if you're satisfied with what you got, I'm the last person who's going to suggest changing it.
I think it's just a question of what are the options.
Right.
And these are budget issues too.
Sure.
Well, is there a legal requirement for officers to send cases to Xenia?
There's a specific statute. It says that if you have a mayor's court and certain cases they break down certain cases where a mayor's court does not have jurisdiction.
In those cases where they do have jurisdiction, is what I'm wondering.
Then, yeah, they basically, the municipal court deals as a, an appellate court. And again, it's a weird set of statutes. There are certain statutes that say, okay, the mayor's courts can deal with these crimes, but they can't deal with these crimes, domestic violence and some other things, which is kind of a bizarre way of doing it. Again, to address your point, you know, you folks are satisfied with it. Well, more power to you. With county courts, you, in my mind, you get the best of both worlds. And again, you're absolutely right. If I were a defendant, I suppose, and I got convicted, I'd get another chance and roll the dice and see if I win this time. I think we want efficiency. The reason that some defendants might get convicted might be because if the mayor is the prosecutor, defense attorney, and the judge, which is anathema to our entire legal system, I don't know how good I'd feel about it if I got convicted. In terms of whether I got a fair shake. But again, if your community feels like you want it, that's fine. Why is it there, the chief probably can tell us here about why fewer and fewer cases go on here and they're going to, I assume, senior municipal court, right?
A lot of it has to do with OVIs because of the enhancement to felonies. The police, the community clearly likes the idea of the mayor's court, and the police department stands behind the community. But we also question not having a prosecutor, because we believe, maybe it's erroneous, but the judge finds guilt or innocence. But at times, the judge will actually break the charge down and serve as a prosecutor. And what we would like to see is a prosecutor. Additionally, we believe at some point, every now and then, people may need to go to jail. And to do so, then, Yellow Springs has to have a budget, money set aside, because if someone does go to jail on a mayor's court charge, the village then has to pay for their incarceration. So we believe to do it correctly, that we should spring for the money for a prosecutor, have a budget that if and when the mayor feels someone should be incarcerated, that we have the funds to actually pay for that incarceration. Right. That's our stance.
Yeah, and again, you put your finger on it. I think that one of the problems is that the idea of, in our entire judicial system, the idea is fair trial. You have a prosecutor who is there to be an advocate for the state or the city. And then you have a defense attorney who balances this out to be an advocate for the defendant, and then an impartial judge. Well, if the judge is the prosecutor, defense attorney, and judge, I can't see how it's logically possible for him to be impartial. Now, the other thing about the prosecutor, I agree, to make the system work, the right way of doing it is have a prosecutor. And in these county courts I'm talking about, in Montgomery County, they've got them all over the state, is that they hire part-time prosecutors. They're private attorneys who have some experience, usually a background in criminal law, and also the judges are part-time. So in terms of a mechanism, it will cost money, but again, there are funds available out there that the state and your counties can pick up part of it. Now, the other, that's no small thing about what the chief mentioned here about putting people in jail. It never seems to hit the news, but it's a huge expense. Montgomery County, they've got massive jail facilities, but they run out of them and have to board their prisoners in other counties around here. And it's shocking. It's hundreds of dollars a day for each inmate in that. Oh, it's incredible how much it costs. In fact, historically, and this is always held true, that you see crimes going up and down over the year. I'm sure the chief would verify this. When things get hot in July, August, September, you're going to see a little bump up in the crime rate, the violent crime rate. Around Christmas and New Year's, you're going to see another bump. I think that's because some people are getting together and they realize too late why they didn't get together the rest of the year. Beer bottles start going. But the point is that just this last August, I filled in for one of the judges for a whole week. And the, I can't remember if it was from the police department or the probation department, went around all the judges and said, well, pick and choose who you're going to send to jail, because we're past the capacity right now, and if you put somebody in and we don't have the legal capacity, you know, there's limits on it, we either have to ship them off to another county and pay for it, or let somebody go.
I'm sure you don't mean that you've decided that they're guilty and you're going to send them to jail first. That sounds that doesn't sound impartial to me.
Oh, no, no, no. We're talking about a general thing said, because there, you have other options in terms of sending them to jail, electronic home detention and all these things. They're not the best, and we're not talking about individual defendants, just in general. When you're sitting here today doing pre-trials or trials, now, if the person is convicted, keep that in mind. For example, if it is a domestic violence case, a bad domestic violence case, I mean, hard to get sent to jail. But I won't feel bad about it if they have to ship somebody to another county, because if that person, I'll make a determination, deserves to be in jail for a number of reasons. But it's a problem. But again, you have subsidies from the county and the state to help that out. I can't imagine it would be a huge burden on you folks. I can't imagine a huge number of people going to jail. But to make it work right, I mean, this is America. In South America, they got judges who, and in Europe, they have, in some countries, they have judges who function the same way. That's why they're called third world countries, I think.
And in, well, also in France, I believe, they have the inquisitorial system.
Right.
Right.
They're basically, you're guilty until you prove yourself innocent. And you have magistrates and judges who basically function as prosecutors. I don't know if I want my bacon in their pan. But that's an option.
Okay, well, that's, I think, very useful and helpful to do that kind of overview about some of the mayor's court issues. Maybe people on the committee or other participants have some other questions related to.
So, one thing that I'm particularly interested in is restorative justice. And I'm wondering, what do the books say about revising a system to incorporate something like that?
As you know, just from the press, there's a new movement going on to address things like that. That's why we have probation departments. On the sentencing forms that we use, there's a whole paragraph in small letters of all of the programs that we have to address things, addiction, they even have a petty theft clinic. Basically, I guess it takes a while to teach somebody it's not right to steal, but it's, who knows. Sure, and it's cost effective. Whether it is ultimately effective, I don't know, because I was just talking about this with a judge yesterday. I've been doing this so long where I'm now seeing the third generation of the same families come through. And this is the sad thing about it. I'm all for restorative justice. I'm all for not using incarceration as the sole problem solver, because it's not. It sometimes creates more, even though there are people who, this may sound draconian, but in my mind, I've seen people who not only should be sentenced to prison, but forever. Not even murders either. These are truly, truly evil people. Most people aren't like that, but there are those people out there. Things like probation, it's counseling, it's never going to fix it, or social demands. I'm all for it, but they're expensive, because you've got to hire the counselors and all that. And in a small municipality like that, I don't know how you work that out.
Jennifer, could you give an example that he could respond to about a type of case maybe and what the outcome might be?
Sure.
And because I think partly what we're interested in is, could we have a system that could do that? And maybe a little different than what you're...
Right. So I guess I'm not talking about cases that we would refer to the municipal court.
For the probation department or something like that.
So I'm talking about something that would come through the mayor's court that could be handled through restorative justice, like a vandalism case, where the victim and the offender would have a conversation and the offender would have to, you know, admit to what they did, and then together they would decide what the best way was to move forward. And it might involve, you know, if it's a broken window, fixing the window, or community service or something like that.
Restitution, things like that.
Right.
Ooh, pick me, pick me.
What, for restitution?
My younger son was with a bunch of kids several years ago. 2 days after graduating, they were doing stupid kid stuff. And one was doing real stupid kid stuff. And the short version is that stole a flare and said, hey, let's throw it in the coach's door. And so my son and two of the others said, this is stupid and wrong, we're leaving. So the idiot does it, doesn't cause any crusted scorch marks. You know, they're looking at it, and there are people from Xenia saying, we need to punish these guys for arson and attempted murder. So the grown-ups said, wait a minute. And the mayor and the police and the guy whose house it was talked about it, and the mayor chewed the kids out, and they paid fines, and my son paid his legal fee. And we, you know, I fixed his house because I'm a repair business, you know, and there wasn't much to do. And the kids went over and did some work at the bus station cleaning up buses, and so it was scared the shit out of me, you know. Instead of taking 17, 18-year-olds and sending them to a court and charging them with attempted murder for doing something stupid the kids do, there's no consequence. It makes much more sense to me. Maybe that's not restorative justice, but the house is restored, and you know, it isn't punitive. It's a learning experience, and fixed it. That makes much more sense to me than going down to Xenia, where people who don't know you say, you're evil, you're fucked. Well,
the nice thing is judges in general have incredible discretion, breadth of discretion on how to do things in terms of punishment. It definitely is not limited just to putting somebody in jail or fighting them. That's what I said, these different programs that they have, some of them are like that. There's one of them where they even go to mediation to try to resolve whatever. A lot of times, you know, those neighborhood problems with assaults and stuff. Yeah, I'm all for those things, but again, if you want that, a professional approach to it, you're going to have to pay for it. Because let's say the mayor does want to do that. Well, who's going to do the mediation? And what happens if one party just...
We have a mediation program.
Right.
Okay, well, that'll take care of the mediation.
Volunteer.
That might work, I don't know.
I do have a question. In your line of work, how many times have you seen a mayor in his court decide a punishment that might have been too harsh or too lenient on a person strictly because of their personal knowledge of that person? How many cases do you think that's affected?
I have no way of knowing, and again, I've never seen a mayor put somebody in jail. But that's one of the things about it, when you have a mayor who is so closely connected to the community. On one hand, I think it's a great thing. In fact, the people who enforce the law, in my mind, should be part of the community because they understand the dynamics of the community, the values of the community, and what have you. But on the other hand, you want to make sure that people's constitutional rights are protected. If, you know, fair trial, but I don't see how you can get a fair trial if you want one when you have a person who is both the judge, the prosecutor, and it just doesn't happen. The thing is that people say, well, you don't need to do that because he has the best interest of the child or whoever it is at heart. Well, yeah, I've lived long enough have an appreciation of human nature where I don't particularly rely on things like that. Now, where do they send your...
Then in the end, you have to then rely on rules, because in your previous statement, you're saying there are judges that have leeway. Well, if they're using their leeway, then they're making judgments on a case-by-case basis, we're all relying on them not to be jerks. And...
Relying on the what?
Not to be jerks.
Oh, you mean the judges?
The judges.
Okay.
And so if we're going to rely on them not to be jerks, and we also have to trust them to make the judgments, or we have to say we don't trust them at all, so therefore we only can use the law to decide. I'm hearing you say both things.
No. I mean, in fact, that was real popular back in the Reagan administration started that about the thing about the law is the law. We can't trust these easygoing judges. So let's have absolute mandatory minimum prison sentences. And We saw, yeah, that's working real well. We have more people incarcerated than any country in the world. So, you know, I often thought, you know, if you are a hammer, every problem you look at is a nail, isn't it?
Yeah.
If I'm into punishment, and that's the solution to every of these problems is punishment. But now you're talking about being jerks, again, human nature. I think most judges try hard to do the right thing, as they see it. But there are jerks, ones that have no business on the bench.
I suspect that's true of most people.
Yeah, well, that's what I'm saying.
I think we have a question.
Yeah.
I wonder if you comment on the system in Germany now, where the whole idea is not punishment, but rehabilitation. And it's been fairly successful, as far as we know.
Well, first of all, I don't know anything about the German model, but I wonder if they try to rehabilitate mass murderers.
Well, I don't know about it. Some people, they say they keep in prison forever.
I hope.
But one of the people that was interviewed that they let out, it killed a woman on contract. And he was in jail for 15 years, but during that period of time, he's allowed out on weekends to be with his family. So it isn't really punishment. The idea is to change them in some way or other so that that doesn't occur again.
Absolutely. One of the goals of the criminal sanction is deterrence, saying, okay, we're going to do something to you that you find so distasteful that you'll sit back and say, ooh, if I do that bad thing again, this is what's going to happen. I don't want that to happen, so I'm not going to do the bad thing again.
Well, it's pretty clear if he did anything like that again, it would be much worse.
And then the next question is, do the citizens feel comfortable having somebody who's a killer released on weekends,
right,
just in the hopes that that he is being rehabilitated? I don't know about that. But it's trying to get to the same thing that you folks are talking about, is that let's fix what's wrong. It's been my experience, certainly in cities, that the people who look at human beings as mechanisms that were perfectly functioning when they were born, something happens between the time they're born and the time they come before the criminal justice system, that something happens, they become broken, and that somehow or another we can come up with a way of fixing what's broken and send them back into society as productive citizens. Some of the people it does work with, I mean, there's a lot of people who go through probation and the various other forms of community sanctions that don't ever offend again. Those type of people probably didn't even need probation to begin with, because they're screw-ups. They're not evil people. I think we all know, and this is true certainly in urban areas, we all know what the crime problem is. We've known it for generations. We are...
Oh, and I'll get to, we have a couple questions.
Yeah, I'll get to it in a second here. But when you're thinking about these community sanctions, meaning probation, and prison point, it's parole, electronic home detention, restitution, all that, that's fine. I'm very supportive of it. It's clearly not effective as a society, like, because we keep producing, we are incredibly efficient at producing cars and criminals. And we all know who produces them, that nobody wants to deal with it. You take a kid who is stealing cars at age 12, take a look at the family background. How many of them come from well-educated parents who are very strict in terms of their moral code? Not too many I've ever heard. It happens, as we know, but the overwhelming majority of them come from a very specific socioeconomic strata. And so if you fix them and then send them back to the environment that created them, it doesn't work too well. That's why, as I mentioned earlier, I've been doing this long enough where I've seen now the third generation of the same family come through as criminals, because they keep going back into the same environment, the same family situation that created them, and it's sad.
Can we take a few more questions?
Yeah, back here.
Hi. I want to go back to the conversation, the question that Dave had about the difference between the discretion and the rules. And I think if I understood what you were saying, and maybe I didn't, but I think the difference is that the discretion, when it's exercised under the three-part justice system of the judge, the prosecutor, and the defense attorney, that's where the discretion is more readily able to be exercised. But when one person is acting as all three, that's when you try to stick more to the rules and have less discretion. Is that kind of what you were saying, or did I not understand?
Maybe I misstated it, that when you have somebody who is both a judge and a prosecutor, it's, I guess you'd call it discretion, but the point is, I wouldn't feel comfortable thinking I'm getting a fair shake, especially if I'm convicted, of course. Because again, we have an advocacy system in this country. And when you have the judge who is functioning as the person who is against you prosecuting you, it's hard for them, maybe not impossible for them to separate those. Where the discretion I was talking about is once a conviction takes place, what they can do with that person.
Any other question,
Pam?
I don't know if I can frame this. I'm not certain where the breaking point or what the point is that people, there's a choice whether they go to a mayor's court or to the county system. But what I understand from some cases is that, of course, if you go to, you know, our jail, if you can post bond, you're out. If you can't post bond, you may be there for some time. If you have money, you will have to hire your own defense attorney.
Yes.
And so, there is both financial and emotional, and certainly there's a difference being carried for perhaps a crime that would otherwise be managed or taken care of without all this extra expense and trauma and possibly some time in jail with possible job loss and other things. So there are human costs.
Yeah.
For doing the system, if it could be managed by mayor's court and is satisfactory, it makes to me a lot of sense.
Well, that's what I said in the beginning. You folks like your system. I guess the mayor gets to pick and choose. He gets to have that easy way versus the go through the legal system. Is that?
Well, that's another question. If a person wants to go through the legal system, do they have that choice here? I don't know.
Hal, did you want to add to that?
No, I have a different question.
I think the chief can answer better than I, but there's some officer discretion as to where they're cited. A lot of the local ordinances are automatically cited to mayor's court. Some of the things like the OVIs normally go to Xenia for the reasons that Mr. Cable has stated. But I believe, and this is the part I'm not sure about, I believe that every defendant has the right, if they're cited to mayor's court, to ask to go to municipal. Is that correct?
If they want a trial, it will be transferred over to municipal court.
Okay.
So they have that option.
So are you saying the officers have the discretion whether or not to send to the municipal court? And,
yes,
and what is the criteria that they are using?
Well, on some things. On some things, they automatically have to go to municipal court.
But if they have the option between one or the other, is there some particular criteria they're using?
No, I mean, it's not defined.
Oh.
They take into circumstances whether or not you're local.
Okay.
You know, we've had people who are from another state. It's much easier to pay a fine through Xenia Municipal Court.
Okay.
Than you can do online. They often are sent that way. I broke down and I've given it to Judith of all the citations and criminal cases from January to the end of June. Almost all the OVIs went to Xenia.
OVI?
Driving while intoxicated. Because it can be enhanced if you have enough of it becomes a felony. The county prosecutor will not use a mayor's court conviction as an enhancement. All DVs have to go, all TPO violations have to go.
Could you expand on that?
I'm sorry, temporary protection order violations,
okay.
All domestic violence cases have to go. We have cases where you have commingled cases where you're indicted already through county court, and then you catch a companion misdemeanor charge.
Out of the same transaction.
Out of that misdemeanor companion charge would then be cited to Xenia because of the working relationship between the two. But most local residents, depending on the violation, most of them are cited through mayor's court.
and something you bring up is a good example and an important example, and that is, you said the prosecutors in Xenia won't use a mayor's court conviction for OVI for the enhancement, because as you know, they have to prove that to get a felony. And the reason is that any conviction that takes place when the person is unrepresented and wanted to be represented is automatically invalid for purposes of enhancement. It's just one of the problems that arise out of this process. And that's why I brought up this thing about not having public defenders or whatever. And by the way, that is not just for OVI cases. That means any case. So domestic violence, as the chief can tell you, you can charge, on a second offense, you can charge it as a, if it's a first degree misdemeanor to begin with, as a felony. But if the person didn't have an attorney and wanted one, they can't use it to enhance. Also, this thing about what the court can do and what they can in terms of case. When I went through the statutes, I could not find any rationale for why in mayor's court statutes there's a list of cases, types of crimes, ordinance and violations they can do, but then the other ones go to municipal court. There's, they never explain why, because an OVI is a first degree misdemeanor, whether it's in Xenia municipal court or here. Yes, sir.
What, could you explain a little bit, what's the enhancement of your charge? Is that
It's for, let's say that you've committed, again, domestic violence as a first degree misdemeanor, and then down the road, and let's say a year later, you're convicted or you're charged with it again. Under Ohio State's revised code, they could, if they're charging, if they're planning on charging you with that second offense as a first degree misdemeanor, use that second charge to enhance the first one and crank it up to a felony. Same thing with OVIs. There's a certain number within a certain period of time. If you get them, they can charge it as a felony.
So if I've already been convicted of something, I can get charged. I can get that bumped up later.
Oh, but they still have the right to challenge it, but they'll charge it as a felony.
Only if you commit the same offense again.
Right.
Okay. Al has a question.
I wanted to follow up on what Helen and I have brought up, and some of the things you said sort of bother me. You talk about seeing three generations of
family members.
And to me that says that the system isn't working very well. And
I agree.
And particularly African Americans, the rate at which we're incarcerated is just atrocious. So what's wrong? Helen was wrong about the bail. The bail, they set the bail, you know, at pretty high levels. If you're poor, you can't get out. You sit in the jail for months and months and months. I think Washington, D.C., several places, and many, many years ago, I think 1979, got rid of the whole bail concept. If you're in jail in Xenia, you know how much it costs to make a phone call to a family member or a friend? $16 for 3 minutes, or 5 minutes. And so the whole system is set up, in my opinion, to sort of maximize the chances that the people are not going to be rehabilitated. You break up families, so the next generation.
And lose jobs.
So, I mean, I think this mayor's court has a heck of a lot to deal with in a more humane way some of these things, and we're going to have less recidivism and less of this second, third generation family because the mayor knows the situation and can find an appropriate action. I'm just really bothered by it.
No, I'm not arguing with you. Okay. If you guys are satisfied with what you have, it's none of my business. I'm not going to tell you to do something different. But if there was a consensus and everybody's satisfied, I don't know if we'd have this meeting or the task force. Yes.
I want to know how drug cases are treated here. I have no idea. Both for people of age and people under age, how are those treated here? Do those go immediately to Xenia, or are they differently looked at?
You brought
up
something I wanted to ask about too. Is you obviously don't have a juvenile court here, but I know in Greene County and Xenia they got a juvenile court. Well, let's say a minor comes before the mayor. The whole idea of juvenile courts is, the ideal of restorative justice is to find, to keep them out of the criminal justice system, to look for other options to address whatever the problem is when you talk about delinquency. And of course, they have the resources to do that. Now, I guess there'd be two options. 18, 19, and you're an adult by then, so you're going to go through the adult system. But if you're less than that, I'm assuming that all the cases go to juvenile court and Xenia.
Correct. I don't think juvenile offenses can be cited to mayor's court.
Right. So. But in terms of how they're treated different, I think they're fair. It's been my experience that the younger you are, you're treated more leniently with the idea that, well, you're young and stupid, yeah, but you'll learn.
Well, my question is, like,
not you personally.
Yeah, that can't be a restorative justice thing, right? Because you're underage. That has to be, like, I mean, can you put them in a program that's like, sure. I mean, it wasn't like you're caught with a bunch of cocaine or something. You just had like some marijuana or right. something, which is still obviously against the law. But like, it's worse one way or the other. That's kind of my question. I don't know if that was clear.
It wasn't. Not to me.
Like, I don't know. I mean, my original question was answered, but like, if you're caught with something that's less than a very serious drug and you're younger than 18, and can that be put through restorative justice, or because it's against the law, does it have to go just to the juvenile court?
Well, if you're under 18, they want to pursue it as an offense, they've got to go to juvenile court. Mm-hmm. But here's something else that we haven't talked about, and this is close to the heart of the chief, I'm sure, is that the first level of discretion that is exercised in a case like this, think of it as a movie that has a start and an end, is with the police officer. And if you have police officers, and that's one of the reasons I'm a big believer in community policing and having your officers be members of the community, in small communities, they know a lot of people, if not everybody. And, you know, there's crimes and then there's crimes. I'm sure she knows what I'm talking about. And sometimes it's better to maybe act informally in dealing with something than going through it all for various reasons. But it's left to, and maybe the chief has regular procedures or policies for that, I don't know. But I've seen that work very well in neighborhood police, where they know what they're dealing with here, and cops have been cops for 40 years. And boy, when they come down and get a hold of your grandma or your mom and say, little Johnny or Susie here, screw it up. Little Johnny or Susie are more worried about going home than they are to jail. But those types of situations anymore, I guess, are getting rare because of the breakup of families now. But,
so we had invited Tom, who has some particular expertise in the Constitution, and at first I was asking him how we could get rid of the Electoral College, but he doesn't want to talk about that. So, but I'm wondering if people have questions related to the Constitution, constitutional rights, citizens' rights through the Constitution. Anybody want to throw that out?
The ones that are most popular are the Fourth Amendment search and seizure rights.
Okay, tell us some more about that.
Years and years ago, I came in and talked to a high school class in Yellow Springs about this, and there was a pretty strong feeling within that classroom among the students that, hey, the police here are mistreating us, they're not respecting our rights, and all this kind of stuff. Well, when I started asking questions about specific situations, what it comes down to is that the police officers, in my opinion, were acting correctly. They had probable cause or for something less, for a stop, for example, it's reasonable suspicion, and the kid was just mad that he got popped, which I understand that. But the point is that police officers have to follow the law like everybody else does, and they have a right to stop you if they have reasonable suspicion that you're in the process of committing some crime. No, but frankly, it doesn't take much to establish reasonable suspicion, where if it's probable cause for a search and that or an arrest, it's a much higher standard. Basically, they have to be convinced that you are probably committing a crime or are armed, for example. There's a whole host of situations. The probable cause, reasonable suspicion. So when you're talking about anybody driving, not just juveniles and that, if the officer has reasonable suspicion that you are in the process of committing a crime, they have a right to stop you.
I think where a lot of kids get mixed up is we don't understand how loosely probable cause is defined. Because upon research, I've had multiple people come up with multiple answers of what probable cause actually is, and it's often up to the officer's, just his opinion, and the rules are so broad that anything practically could be justified.
You've got to go to law school if you've got a good handle on this. You can read through the law cases, maybe you have, and I guarantee you, you can come up with easily with 10 different definitions of probable cause, almost exactly the same. But usually, they pick a word that maybe a synonym of another one. But what it really comes down to is, and this can be tested, is whether that officer, looking at all the facts and circumstances that is present at the time, that this officer has to make a decision, can they say, me, the police officer here, based on the facts and the circumstances that exist out there, am I convinced that this person is probably committing X crime? And if the officer comes back and says, yeah, I feel that way, and then goes ahead and investigates and, let's say, ultimately arrests him, that, you're right. There is no absolute black line test that you can apply. It is so much based on, first of all, it's totally dependent on the facts and circumstances that the officer is confronting. But it can be tested. Let's say you are arrested and you say, hey, look, I shouldn't have been arrested because this officer didn't have probable cause to arrest me. And in your studies, you found out that if it turns out to be an illegal arrest, that anything they discovered, let's say drugs on you, cannot be used against you. Fruit of the poisonous tree, all this kind of stuff. Okay. Now, that can be tested in motion to suppress. So it's not left just to the officer, and the meeting officers should go around, and bad officers go around and just arrest anybody based on something other than probable cause, because it can be tested. But the problem with, of course, the system, like any other human system, is that we're dealing with human beings. And for example, I had, about 3 weeks ago, had a motion to suppress. And I've had a lot of those, and it was for, ultimately it was for drugs. And this officer stopped this person and had the camera going and basically said, yeah, I saw all of this, and that's why I stopped him. When I stopped him, I saw some drugs in his lap and a crack pipe or something like that. Okay. Well, from all the facts and circumstances, and this is all on the record, it was so clear that he didn't have probable cause. Now that we're here to learn, and that I'll be very honest with you what my opinion was. It was about 2 o'clock in the morning on the west side of Dayton. It's a black male with a beautiful black Cadillac. We had a video showing, followed him, and here are the traffic lines, because he said, well, he swerved across the traffic. I've never seen anybody drive straighter than that guy did. I don't know if that was his motivation, but it was clearly not, and therefore he didn't have reasonable suspicion to stop him, and therefore I kicked it out. It doesn't always happen that way, but.
Yeah. I was going to say about that was probably my biggest issue, is that national distrust with the police, not just here, and probably less here than in other places, but it's starting to spread everywhere, is probably due based mostly off of those bias cases where it's not necessarily only racial, but heavily racial or otherwise. I think here it's less racial, probably more like you know that person to have possibly maybe offended in the past, or maybe it could be a more personal level. I've had people express that to me before. But just the biased, and then finding probable cause based off of bias, and being able to not necessarily make things up, but embellish based off of knowing that person.
Like, I know that guy's a crook, so
right.
He's probably bad.
So, like, well, you'll find something. And I'm not saying all officers are terrible or anything like that, not, at all. But it's just like being able to find something somewhere that wasn't necessarily the reason you pulled them over.
Again, you're dealing with human beings, and you have that a camera that goes through the windshield that records the stop and all that kind of stuff. That's one of the reasons that, in fact, I just read this last week, you know, the controversy about body cameras. Other than undercover people, I am a huge believer. First of all, I've had some trials recently where the whole thing was filmed, which showed clearly the defendant was lying through his teeth during the whole thing. And the officer did absolutely the correct thing. But also, if you had body cameras like that, I think that that would deter people, cops who are acting wrongfully, from doing it. In fact, they found in the city so far, they've only been out there for not that long a time to do a full study, but so far in cities that have adopted mandatory body cameras, their number of police use of force complaints have gone down 70%. 70%. In some of the cities, it was 80-some percent. Because I think it's good for everybody. It's a deterrent. You know, there's, I don't know what the chief feels about it, but there's, I guess, arguments the other way. Of course, you wouldn't do it with undercover people. And that'd be a little problem, walking into a drug house with a camera.
So in the case that you were looking at with that motion to suppress, isn't that case almost like the exception that proves the rule? Like, they're the one in a million person that was actually able to follow all of the traffic laws so that they couldn't be stopped illegally, but like 90%+ of people can't do that, to the point where some departments actually included in their like drug courier profiles like follows all traffic laws as like that would make someone more likely to be a drug courier than someone that was actually violating them. But if you violate,
so you arrest them because they're following the law.
Right. Yeah. Oh.
Well, you suspect them.
Oh, I. Well, you suspect them that
because they're following the
reasonable
law.
Suspicion.
Exactly. So that's
personal. They're acting so legally. We got to arrest them.
So it's just like any kind of bias you have, you can act upon because anything could be the reason.
I mean, I'm not saying that necessarily, but I mean, like department. It would be reasonable because almost
right.
everyone violates.
Right.
It actually would be kind of reasonable to assume someone that did.
It's been my experience. When you talk to these officers who make traffic stops because they suspect the person is OVI or whatever else, it's been my experience where they'll follow them for a while and just going over the line a little bit once, or maybe even on that line twice, they're not going to stop you. I mean, most officers won't. But what they're looking for is a pattern.
But if the defendant that was before you had gone over at all, any sort of minor violation, then the motion to suppress would have failed.
Well, I mean, did they have any reasonable suspicion that he was violating a traffic law?
Right. If he'd driven like a normal person
once, would that have been enough to say probable cause?
Most officers, I don't think.
But this officer wanted to stop this man. Had the man.
In my opinion, yes, and not because he was violating traffic laws.
Somebody behind me here, sorry.
Yeah, could you give a quick, what's the difference between reasonable suspicion versus probable cause?
It's when I've taught this, I say what you're talking about in terms of reasonable suspicion, probable cause, and proof beyond a reasonable doubt, how they differ are levels of probability. For reasonable suspicion, all an officer has to come up with is, again, it's totally based on the existing facts and circumstances. The officer has to look at these facts and circumstances and say, hey, do I think that it's possible that this person is violating some law that would justify a stop? Just, is it possible? It's low standard. Probable cause is higher standard, and that is it probable, not possible, is it probable that this person is violating the law? If the answer is that, then you got it. And of course, beyond a reasonable doubt is the highest standard of proof of probability, if you will, in our whole system.
So could you relate that to what's known as, and I'm using a technical term, Terry stop?
Oh, that's based on reasonable suspicion. Number one, if a police officer has reasonable suspicion that the person is armed or committing some type of unlawful activity, the officer can stop it. Now, the next question is, what can they do? Can they strip search him? And unless they find something when they pat him down, because they have a right to pat him down, you know, if they pat him down and feel something through his pocket, it feels like a 9mm Ruger, officer has a right to pull it out and probably handcuff them unless they can, unless they have a concealed carry with that. But again, they have a right to pat them down, stop them, pat them down if they had reasonable suspicion. They don't have to have probable cause. And if the person's clean, no problem.
So you can have reasonable suspicion in some place or because of the person you know, because of past experience that you have or that you have with them. And then if they start doing something that's problematic, that would be probable cause to take it further.
Yeah, in fact, even the Ohio Supreme Court has used that example, saying an officer who, let's say, has arrested this guy, and this guy's been convicted before for multiple drug offenses, and the officer comes up on this same guy again, and it appears that he might be holding drugs because he sees him talking to somebody and passing a tiny little glassine envelope. The fact that that person has been arrested, convicted of drug offenses, that can be part of the facts that that officer can consider. And
so that would be the first level, reasonable
yes.
suspicion. Yeah. Handing it over would be probable cause.
Yes.
So the fact that they have prior offenses plays into reasonable suspicion. Would that possibly hinder the process? What we're trying to do with restorative justice, where if someone had a drug offense prior and they were reformed for it, but it's still used as like reasonable suspicion against them, would that, many people say that they commit crimes because they feel like they're stuck in that loop and they can't get out of it. Would that harm the restorative justice?
I agree if that's the only thing the officer had. First of all, in terms of the officer's knowledge is this person has a prior conviction. That alone, emphasize alone, is never enough for reasonable suspicion. It has to be something else. Something in addition, I should say.
So what happens after I've been stopped? What information do I have to give out? Yeah. Watch too many videos or police are saying, give me this information, person saying, I don't want to. What am I required to say?
They have a right to ask you, who you are and that, and ask for your driver's license and your proof of financial responsibility. Really, if they start asking you questions that could implicate you in criminal activity, and you only would probably know it if you're involved in it, sure, you don't have to answer those questions. If they start asking you, well, are you carrying any drugs on you? Do you have any weapons? No. Believe me, this happens all the time. And you say no, or just don't answer, that's fine. But for him to, or her, the officer, to search your car, for example, they have to have a lot more than just reasonable suspicion.
I don't know if this is different from like county to county, but when someone is pulled over, is the passenger required to give their ID? Or is the passenger, because I know sometimes police officers will ask for the passenger's ID, and I don't know if we are required to hand it over.
Right.
That's a good question because the cases that have come down the pike, I don't recall any about just asking for the ID. Most of them are having them get out of the car.
Yeah.
And now, if the officer, based on the officer's information, it looks like the officer may be in danger because from the passenger, because of maybe a hidden weapon or whatever, certainly the officer has a right to have him leave the car so that they can see his hands. I'm talking about passenger.
Yeah.
I don't think there's any problem asking that person to produce some identification. Now, in terms of questioning the passenger doesn't have to answer those questions.
But is the passenger legally, like, obligated to hand over their ID if they're not the one driving?
Right.
I can't think of a case right now that says it, but my guess is they'd come back and say yes because the driver asked it.
Okay. Right.
If I may?
Yes.
It's my take. If you're a passenger car and that car is stopped solely for a traffic purpose, mm-hmm. the driver is obligated to identify himself, the passengers are not.
Okay.
But if that car is stopped for a criminal purpose, we believe it just left a convenience store and stole cigarettes, now everyone could be suspect and therefore everyone in the car would have to require their ID. And most officers are going to ask everybody in the car for ID. And you can always say, am I suspected in a crime? And if the answer is no, you say, I don't want to give it to you. There should be no reparation and no problems with that. Okay, so.
Okay.
That's a very good example, because the convenience store robbery, let's say the information the officer has is that the robbery took place and there were two people involved in the robbery. Pulls up behind the car, let's say they have a license number or whatever, and there are only two people in there. Sure, I mean, there's no question they can get the passenger out because you may have been an accomplice in the robbery. Now, the other thing is, one of the reasons that they wanted to check ID, I'm sure the chief will agree with me, is to see if there's any active warrants on them. And quite often, there are active warrants out of some court form that they skipped or whatever. Yeah.
I just wanted to state that while technically the officer does require probable cause to search a vehicle without the person's consent, most officers, even if they have probable cause, will ask the driver for consent to search the vehicle. And I believe that studies have found that 90%+ of people that are stopped will consent to
even if they know there's contraband or whatever. I agree.
Yeah, with the view, and when they're asked why, basically they all say because they thought that the officer was going to search anyway. But now that they've consented, there's absolutely no way that they can challenge the constitutionality of the stop.
If it's truly voluntary consent, and under your set of facts, the officer gets up there, rolls down the windows, talking to the person, and says, okay, can I search your car? And if the person says yes, and there was no threats or intimidation, tough luck. And that, you're right. It always amazes me when I see them. They have 20 pounds of marijuana in their trunk. And so, yeah. What were they thinking? Like the officer's not going to pop the trunk or anything?
Well, it's been connected to the like Milgram's obedience experiments that basically like it's a person of authority asking you for something, and like everyone's been trained from a young age to be deferential.
It works to law enforcement's value.
Just to be clear, that can't be used against you in any way in the future. Like if you if the officer thinks that's suspicious, that for some reason you won't like hand over your ID or anything, and they see you later, they can't use that in any way, right?
Oh, no. I mean, because you have a right under those circumstances to, and if you're really worried about this thing, if an officer stops you and start questioning you, one of the first things you can ask them is, am I under arrest, officer? Because if the officer says no, then fine. But if you keep talking and give them new information, if under that new information, he might be able to arrest you.
Can you leave at that point if the officer says no?
I definitely ask them first, am I under arrest? If I'm not under arrest, then I get to leave, don't I?
But if it's a Terry stop, you might not be able to, even though you're not under arrest?
Oh, no. If he has a reasonable suspicion to stop you after, let's say, that he does a frisk of you and doesn't find any contraband, no drugs or weapons, nothing like that, well, then let's see that's found something, you have a right to leave.
Can you go back to the weapons? Like, when's a good time to let the chief know that I've got a .357 in my glove box?
Well, no, you got a concealed carry?
Yeah, no.
You don't?
Yeah.
In this hypothetical case?
Yeah, or no.
I need to wear it on the outside, then. Is that the idea?
Well, the open carry, there's no problem with that. The problem is you're in a vehicle.
I need a holster, then, is what you're saying.
Oh, no, you don't have a holster. The problem is you're in a vehicle.
Yeah.
And if you have a concealed carry, the first thing you do, of course, is put your hands on the steering wheel. Yeah. The officer rolls down the window. Officer, I want to inform you right now that I have a loaded .357 Magnum, and I have a concealed carry permit, and then let the officer go from there. Now, if you're driving around with a .357 in your glove box and you don't have a concealed carry, you got some problems.
Oh, so I need to. It's really hard, you know, when you put the seatbelt on to have that.
You know, I never had that problem.
So what if it's in the trunk?
Unloaded in the trunk? Yeah, I don't see any problem. Chief, do you?
Yeah, it has to be what is known as ready at hand.
Right.
And so especially if you're going to go shoot and you put your .357 in the trunk and the bullets in the glove box, it's not ready at hand. It's not capable of shooting, right. Or vice versa.
Right. Right.
But when they are together, then that is ready at hand.
Even in the trunk?
The trunk is not really ready at hand, I don't believe, because you actually physically have to get out of the car and
get my gun.
When do you like to know, though, that I've got this gun at any time?
When's the best time? If you're not incriminating yourself, I would say at the very, very beginning, you nonchalantly just "Officer, just so you know, I've got a loaded weapon on me." And we just stopped not that long ago, ended up with a robbery warrant on the passenger of the car. The driver, since they came up, said, "Just so you know," he's a very large man, said, I'm carrying a Glock 9, I'm sitting on it." The officer said, "Okay, no problem." Got the guy, he eventually ended up identifying the passenger. Passenger had a robbery warrant on him, got him out, got him handcuffed, took off, never even had the driver get out of the car. I mean, it was no problem. We're, you know, cops are used to that.
Sitting on a Glock 9?
And if it's loaded in the trunk,
that's a little.
Yeah, and some of these counties change a little bit. Montgomery County is a little more of a liberal county when it comes to the prosecution and stuff than it's Green. Montgomery County, we would not have charged someone with a, it might have been improper handling of a firearm and motor vehicle at best. Green County, sometimes there's a little leeway in those things.
Isn't it supposed to be that if you have a weapon in the vehicle, the weapon is supposed to be unloaded in one compartment of the vehicle and the ammunition is in another?
Yes, it was best to put the ammo in a separate place.
We're going to have to come to a close because we still have a committee meeting that's going on.
Before I leave here, to give you something else.
Yeah, okay. We'll get to that in a minute. And I just want to thank everyone who came. And obviously, there's... sometimes the justice system seems like dismay and you're not sure where you go in or how you get out. And I think as a committee, we want to say that we have the intention of continuing to do more education. And obviously, I'm pretty sure the chief would be willing to show up and answer questions, further questions. And we'll maybe pass out your webpage. Okay, I'm going to thank Tom for spending this time with us. Really appreciate him coming from Dayton. Hope that we don't see him in the court. But
well, I believe in restored justice. Before
okay,
I leave, I just wanted to mention a little known resource that we're all paying for through our tax dollars is the U.S. Justice Department. They have all of these institutes and everything else. And all you have to do is just put up their United States Justice Department and it'll lead you to it. For example, they have one on neighborhood partnerships. Where they can do training, both of the community and the police officers. They have a National Institute of Justice that does training, and they have separate institutes that fund these things. So if you want to send, things are moving, I think, and they have been for a while, toward enhancing this idea of community policing. But it takes a community, not just the officers, a community, and there's all sorts of programs that you can get grants for, so it's not money out of your pocket. And they have incredible amount of resources that are open to communities. And I just wanted to let you know that because it's hardly anybody knows that it exists.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Yeah.
All right. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, the problem is, they don't know what
chief
is.
It depends on the drug. We can explain if you want to call me Monday or Tuesday.
Let's just start with a little housekeeping. I think everyone heard me say that Ellis was with a friend and for that sort of thing. So he sends his regrets, but he's the person who got Tom here, and I think that was we probably should try and meet, go back to our regular schedule, which is the second Tuesday. And we pretty much, maybe not everybody heard this, people who weren't here or whatever, but we decided we'd start at 7. Is that okay with everybody? So that would be, what date would that be? Somebody got their calendar. December.
Are we going to do the second Thursdays?
Second. Yeah, Tuesday. Were we on Tuesdays?
Oh, second Tuesday.
Second Tuesday.
It's the 13th.
It's the 13th. So it'll be December 13th, and we'll send out an email as well. And we had said at our last meeting that we would try by the new year, that is in January, we would do our sort of phase one of each of the work groups. Phase one being kind of the baseline, where we, what we've learned so far, that we would try and get that done by January. And we didn't necessarily discuss what that looks like, but any, I think almost, we don't have to have a consistent reporting. You know, somebody might have charts, look at this cool chart that we're about to get, or we can have, you know, some written things, or I don't know, the video group was still talking about that. So however we do it, just that we have something that we, some, even if it's a draft form, by January, so that's kind of where we are. So what we can do right now is just have quick report outs about what our different work groups have done. Anybody want to start with that?
Why don't we start?
You're the charts. Mayor's court people?
Yeah, that's going to take it on. Okay. Al put these together, got them from the mayor's court. And you want to talk about them, Al, or me too? Would you like to talk about them?
Well, Dave and Steve and I are on the mayor's court subgroup, and so we met and we sort of talked about what we were going to do. And so I don't want to talk about what the data means. I just thought that we thought it would be good to pass it out so that you could look at it, and then this gives you some factual basis then for later on when we talk about the mayor's court, about what actions we would recommend or what. So this is just Dave.
The first two charts are the same, just one slightly smaller than the other.
Oh. Yeah.
And spread out. And Al, though, on both of those first two charts, it says speeding divided by five. I assume that means that speeding places were much
greater. Much higher. Yeah, I just, in order to scale it down, the speeding cases were five times bigger, but I wanted to keep it to scale. And the dollars are in thousands, just so.
And I wanted to say a little bit about what I'd heard Mayor Covert say in August to a group meeting that I was at. Some key things that I think are significant to go along with this. He's saying that he's been in office for 24 years,
yeah,
something
yeah,
like that, a long time.
Close to 25.
For the first couple of decades, they averaged about 20 to 30 cases a month. And as of mid-August, they'd seen 16 for the whole year. So there's a numerical image about how drastically the number of cases have gone down. And he was told that initially when he started that this is not a money-making venture, you know, and don't try and get cases through to make lots of money, and he believes in that too. But at the same time, the cost had been borne by the fees and the fines. I'm remembering this from my notes, so I might be off by a little bit, but something like $30,000 a year for the cost, and they were making that money with the. They were covering the cost by the fees and the fines and whatnot, but now they're not getting that kind of money. He also said that the last two chiefs have told officers to send lots of cases to Xenia, and he was saying Ron Lewis told them to do that. In some comment, I'm not quoting perfectly about requirements, which is why I badly asked Tom the question about what was required there, so that was a concern to me. And Fobert's view is generally it'd be better to send a lot of people through here rather than down to Xenia for these kinds of things. So I'm going to throw that out also.
And he has no control. He sees whoever is referred by the police.
Yes.
Yeah. So our goal is to get into this kind of data at as much more as we can. Seems appropriate having to do with the kind of cases, the number of cases, frequency, more specifics having to do with money.
I think what Tom was saying is that there's this push to do across the way with mayor's courts, but there are some mayor's courts that are pretty thriving in Ohio, so that would be one thing that would be useful to. Granville was the one that the Yellow Springs News brought forward as an example. To find some comparison seems like it could be helpful.
see what they do, what their numbers are.
Well, the main reason though was the corruption. There was four that, there were four towns called that mayor's court that basically had a full stay from the officers on up, catching people from out of town, charging way over the actual cost of what the speeding was. And four towns got caught in this thing where it was like family run kind of things that were done. And this was what the push for the game, bring up them were. So, yeah, even firing ones out.
There's some abuses, yeah.
Right, which is what they were afraid of. And, I love your idea of, if there's other good ones out there, we'd like to follow that. This is a good one. I mean, yeah. I think that's what sounds interesting if people are here to actually ask what we can do to keep the mayor's court.
Well, I'd just like to say something, just unless it had, I don't know. So this guy and our chief is saying, because we don't have a prosecutor.
Exactly, that's a big issue.
That's the biggest thing. That's why they're not sending him to the mayor's court. Personally, I think we can look at that and question, do we need to have a prosecutor? Do we need to have a defendant? That's a question. We don't need to get into it now. But I think that's something that should be examined.
And what would it cost?
Well, yeah, but first of all, what's the value? Is it really necessary?
Sure. Ask the money question and answer.
But it is possible that we could have a prosecutor. I mean, that council has talked about this. So that's part of what you all, we'd like you to be looking at, you know, if there are mayor's courts that are working, do they have a prosecutor, do they have a defendant, what do they do about that? Are there ones that don't? Is that okay? And clearly we have a conflict going on because it seems like most people in the community like mayor's court and the police don't.
Right.
The chief doesn't.
Right, because they would immediately say the opposite.
They work for us, isn't that right?
They do, and see, and council can direct, my understanding is council can direct the police to send all cases that can go to mayor's court to mayor's court. Council can do that. So we're going to be looking at you guys to be making that recommendation or whatever.
Yeah.
And I heard him say, and I think it is an issue, if you don't have the prosecutor and the defending attorney, you're not really, that's not our...
It's not the adversary system.
So the question is, has that caused any abuse? And I think it's so far it has not.
I mean, I didn't realize he was a judge.
He's a judge.
So he's coming from the judge's position, and I was very disappointed when
I think he has a point that you just have to consider. So I think the question is, are there mayor's courts that are being really grandled?
Well,
they have a prosecutor.
We will explore we've got another month explore that and come back.
But did you say there's a choice? Like if you think you're being treated unfairly, you can recommend yourself to go?
Yeah.
Yes.
So,
no, the question is the opposite true, because if we had an issue with HRC where someone requested to go to mayor's court because it was something that was completely local, they're local. There was no one that wanted to listen to how that traffic stop can't be seen from where the officer was. They're explaining to us, we knew what they were talking about because we live here, we know that they were sent out there, and it was like their main question was I sent out there because they know that there is no listening to the argument and that this way the officer has to be right and that they couldn't have done anything wrong. So it's like, we'll just send it out there. This way you're wrong. We're not going to have someone who's local listen to your local issue from an officer who's not from here. So we send it out there. That way, everything, tickets rewrite, all do get prosecuted.
But we can tell them to send everything that
this is where our goal is to.
To that court, and then if they think there's an abuse, then they can recommend to go on to the municipal person.
Well, that one you already have.
Right.
And we should point out
the thing is you don't have the opposite.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. We can tell them to send all of them possible to the mayor's court, and then if the person thinks that there's an abuse, can the officer challenge it if they think there's they're being too lenient in the mayor's court?
That's a good question.
Yeah.
What did you want to add, John?
Oh, just that for minor misdemeanors, you don't have a right to a lawyer anyway.
Right.
So you could end up in the county without a lawyer because you were charged with a minor misdemeanor.
Right, right, right. Well, there's plenty to keep thinking about, obviously, so. Okay, our police department group, Cage is challenged with a family emergency, ongoing emergency. Her mom is very ill. So it's been hard for her to get in on it, but John and I have met with the chief, and I've focused a lot on our hiring practices and our training, our required training, and I've both gotten some records from the chief about what kind of training people have gone through, and looked at all the requirements of the Ohio Peace Officer Training Commission and the requirements of basically the state requirements from the Attorney General's office. I mean, one of the things that's interesting, one insight that's interesting is that because of all the attention to problems with police and the three or four murders in Ohio in the last couple of years, the state has increased the required training hours. From this year it was 11 hours, next year it's 21, and they're pushing for 40 hours of professional training. And they have particular required courses. For example, some of the courses from 2016 were de-escalation of mental health crisis, use of force, missing child, crisis intervention, policing in the 21st century, the use of force and de-escalation. So these are courses that the Attorney General's Office and the Police Commission have designed. And the challenge is, or the question is, how adequate are these courses? Because some of them are 1 hour, where they're online. But they do have a list of required courses, and they have a whole other list for the year that's coming up. And you know, that's just interesting to know about.
Does Ohio do bias training, or is that not here?
Well, bias training is the most difficult kind of training. Yes. And right now the Justice Department, he mentioned the Justice Department's website, they have required all of their, I mean, they're having the whole entire enormous Justice Department go through bias training. Mm-hmm. But it hasn't really been developed in a way that it can be delivered so far to community police. So, you know, the question is it out there somewhere? And if it's out there somewhere, it wouldn't necessarily be, this training is all paid for. Mm-hmm. So if we found bias training, say the University of Indiana and bias training or whatever, it wouldn't be paid for through the program. So it's just, interesting to see. But there are some options in training. For example, working with the mentally ill, you can request that another training is approved, like NAMI, the National Association of Mentally. You could ask for their training instead of the governor's, instead of the attorney general's training.
So it's required to have some training, but you could pick.
Well, you can't pick, you have to have it approved.
Yeah,
and NAMI is approved.
Yeah, I just mean it isn't. You got to have this training if you have the training in this area, and or
you,
something
you
else.
You either have to do the training through the police academy that's approved, or you have to request approval to have it from some other vendor. So that's that. And the new, I think particularly there's I would personally have an interest in training new officers, and right now that is all about things like how to use the taser safely. And it's all compliance things. So that's, they don't, and you know, we did have an officer who was released, didn't complete probation because of some of his behavior. And you know, almost everyone, including the chief, has said, well, he didn't really get a good sense of community. That wasn't part of the training that he got at the front end.
Can I make a suggestion?
Yeah.
I went on, anybody, all of you, I'd urge you to sign up for a ride-along with the police department. It takes a week or two to check your, make sure you're okay. I went on a ride-along of a couple weeks ago for 5 hours. It was very, very interesting. I mean, there were 3 parking tickets, 1 speeding stop, and 1 vendor type thing. And but I saw the paperwork they had to file. And I really got some insights in it, but there, so that's the positive side. The negative side, it was very, the attitude of the person I was writing this was very troubling, because he was quite proud of the, he said, I can stop virtually anybody for, see that license plate? The thing, the holds the license plate covers that, I could stop him for that. And I mean, it was really sort of troubled. I was very troubled by some of the attitude, and and so we talked about some of the stuff.
Yeah, and that's what I was talking about earlier, when you can pull anybody over for anything that you possibly see. That's not reasonable suspicion or whatever, but like you pull them over and then you find something else that could be reasonable suspicion,
and he was proud of that.
Okay, let's keep going. So the other part of the report, John, is about the data and record keeping. You want to tell us what you're doing?
Okay, yeah. So first of all, I'd also like to say that we have all the Yellow Springs Police Department's policies in electronic format.
Yeah, we have those.
And also, I guess, in connection to the data that y'all got in connection to the court, I was wondering how we should share the information in the committee. Should we use like Google Drive or Dropbox?
No PDF files.
Mm-hmm. No, you can put those
PDF
on.
PDF files.
Yeah, I don't want a PDF file unless you don't have it. I want to be able to modify the data. I'm just throwing it out.
Well, then, so you could do a couple of Google Drives. You could use Google Docs too.
Well, they're giving us the data in whatever format they're giving us.
Oh, okay.
And you guys have the data in whatever format you have it. Yeah. I'm just asking like how we should share it.
Right.
If people have Google Drive, that's what I've got. So let's do that.
Yeah.
All right, cool. Yeah. All right.
I want to point out that I did, John, I had a little bit of a discussion back and forth about my concern that we create an awareness. A lot of the data that comes from the police, even though it's public records, it includes some very private information about citizens. It has their addresses, their problems.
We wouldn't put that on the drive.
Okay, well, let's be sure that we're... And if we do, that does come out in whatever ways, cases in the court or anything, that we just have an agreement about being sensitive to that. And no gossiping.
Mm-hmm. All right.
We have to.
I shouldn't have joined this group.
We've been requesting the citation, warning, and incident data back to 2010, which is also pretty much when they adopted their database records keeping system that they're currently using called New Worlds. The chief doesn't really know how to like export the information out of the database that we need. And he's asking Sergeant Knapp to develop the report. He said that Knapp has been off last week and all of this week due to a medical procedure. Once the report is developed, he'll be happy to provide it. It may be a couple weeks before it is available.
It is a huge amount of data, we want to say that. And the chief, for example, said that when you're talking about calls for service, he said that 18 calls on a weekend day, that'd be 43 calls for service. So if you were to do a year, it'd end up being, 500 pages or something. So, I think that we have to think of a little bit about what are the questions we think would be answered by collecting all this.
He must have a summary.
Sorry?
He must have a summary.
Not necessarily.
No, the only thing that when we met with him, he basically was like, all we've got is like total number of citations. It's like meaningless numbers. Imagine you guys got more detail, like what each actual thing was for, like whether it was for speeding.
Well, the 911 calls, it says what they're for.
Yeah, the 911 calls they were for,
The citations.
No, but he was asking like, oh, but surely he is. So the thing is that basically, so two things that I should say about the department historically that'll put more of this context, including the policies. So before Hale arrived, they had like 5 policies total. Basically the department until extremely recently, until a couple of years ago, has been operating with like no written policies whatsoever on anything. All policies that you will be seeing are extremely new. The other thing to note about the database is that basically, while larger departments use these databases to like actually manage the department, understand what the department's doing, because you can't be everywhere at once, our department's been so small that there's been absolutely no need for any of the police administrators to ever really learn how to use their database management systems, because they can just look at each individual case and watch each thing that each officer does, basically.
They look at the reports in the morning and decide. They don't really use it. They don't really use the database.
Yeah.
Makes sense.
Yeah.
So. Okay. Any questions about the data that's being collected? Okay, then.
Are we going to have to go through that? Is that what you're saying? We're going to get all this and then it'll be up to us to be like, okay, this citation led to this, or is there no way to get what the citations led to?
So we did ask that question, and he seemed to say that, yeah, there wasn't any way to connect the police data to the data that y'all got. And okay. That's also what I read when I was just, I've also read that other places, just like when national reporters are talking about doing their reporting.
There is, however, people in Beaver Creek who are using the same database, so they might be able to do more for you.
Yeah, so I called Deborah Moyer, who works for the Sheriff's Department, and she basically said that everything that I'm requesting, she said it was possible for them to get us that information in electronic form. So in theory, it should be done, and that's where I'm standing, and I'm not going to
What is the purpose?
Okay, so for the citation data, basically you're asking, so what are people getting cited for? Which sheds like a little bit of light on like crime and on like crime, you know, for especially for victim crime, and then for things like speeding and like more crimes that you would not expect that the officer could have found out about them by someone having called the department. It sheds some light on basically how officers are, like what sort of things officers are investigating on their own, right? If you're looking at domestic violence, there's like zero chance that the officer just found that out through their own investigations. Somebody had to call. If it's speeding, there's like zero chance that somebody called the department, the officer had to investigate. And then there's other ones that would be a little bit blurrier in terms of what it meant, but for certain things you can be like, okay, so that this is what's crime in Yale Springs, this is what our officers do. So for calls for service, the question is kind of like, why are people calling 911? Which is obviously even broader than because people call for all sorts of reasons. And I mean, like, it's hard to say what useful information comes out of that, but I feel like we should know. We're doing a systematic.
It seems to me that there are some things over which, and I'm thinking of this perhaps narrowly through the mayor's court lens, you know, some things that can't go through mayor's court. And we have more control over that. I mean, there aren't that many murders, but just to pick something that doesn't happen very often, I wouldn't bother counting the murders.
Right.
Or, you know, things like that. And so if there's a way to eliminate looking for those things, that might make it easier for you. I don't know if it is or not. I don't know what the numbers are, but
I'm just wondering if sampling rather than trying to do.
It seems like you could pull out like drug offenses, arrests for drugs, out of that database, and things like that. If you specify the category that would be of interest.
Well, yes.
We get all the data from
the database in one file.
Right. So
and what software uses it? Is it unique to the police department, or can it be put into Excel or something like that?
So, like one of the standard formats that like should be exportable and importable from any like database management system would be like a comma separated. It's like .csv, comma separated values, where it's just like. It's just like columns and rows. That's basically all
everything
is. It's just columns and rows.
Because we can do that
as columns and rows. and rows, and then we can import it to Excel, and then I can do an analysis on it.
Is it possible to do that? That's a question I'm asking.
So according to Deborah Moyer, who's their IT person, it all was theoretically possible. It seems to me that it's strictly, this is the hypothesis I'm working on right now, that the only problem we're running into is that the administrators here haven't had any reason to learn how to do it.
I think that would be best, because that would be simplest and easiest to share.
Yeah.
Several years ago, I was working with the committee to pass a tool, and I got a disk with that very kind of information, all the information about all the voters in Greene County. And there were 45,000 people, mm-hmm. and there were 5 million pieces of information per person with lots of redundancy. And I just wanted Yellow Springs, and so very quickly I could call out all of them. Turned out that there were 4,500 registered voters in Yellow Springs and only 3,500 residents, but that's a different issue. But it was very easy to quickly get rid of a lot of it to get down to what we wanted. So I would say get it in that format.
And, you know, probably both Al and David could get together with John to think through how are you going to manage that much data and for what.
The database goes to the state.
How about if we don't talk about it now, but that the three of you get together and try and think through how you manage that much data? I think that would work better. Okay, the committee that is working on public perception, community building, trust. Steve, John, and Dave, did you meeting at?
We were focusing on the process. Yeah, I'm not.
This group would consider options for collecting information, surveys, interviews, storytelling, using Yellow Springs News in public meetings, looking at the recent attempts of surveys in public meetings.
Okay, guys.
It's all coming
that
back.
Part sounds
it's
a lot
all coming
good.
Back.
Well, now we've been working on that. I'm working with David O'Donnell, more scientific, basically broad survey of everyone's opinion, good or bad. And then what John and I would like to do is actually work a lot more personal experiences. Really good things they've done that uh-huh. people can say, and really bad experiences that people have had interacting with the police. Because it's been brought up that people, we should also go to them with what they're doing correctly and keep that in. So. Instead of just having a rule book of, here's what you guys need to stop doing, it wouldn't be too bad to also be like, but you've perfected this, or you act this down correctly, and the community clearly loves this. However, these are some also major issues, blah, blah, blah. And so that's just going to be, flat out, we're just going to go out and interview folks, and there will be like actual questions, and then their stories will be their stories. We want to make sure that they know that they're comfortable and that there's nothing will reach anything beyond what we have.
Does it seem like you'll be able to do a sample of that, maybe?
Well, yes, because if we have 10 stories, so people think like, all of my black friends get arrested in this, but you know, then we would know that that is clearly a problem. Or all women seem to have this problem with this officer. These things will show once you interview enough people. However, then there's just the other one of the community as a whole, rating from 1 to 5, you know, blank. You, whenever you interact with them, blank, whenever, you know, and just that sort of more scientific, flat out. Turns out 70% of the community thinks police are fine, and there's a, and so we can use. We'll end up using, be able to use both. To kind of
didn't the news do that at one point, the Yellow Springs?
They tried SurveyMonkey, which...
It didn't work.
Yeah, this is one of those, like, we'd rather, I mean, if we got a knock on the door sort of thing, because, well, first off, you can use 5 different email accounts, so if someone finds out that this is linked to this, they'll... Well, I don't want them to do that, or an officer could do that, or someone who absolutely trusts the police could also do the same.
Right.
So this way we would actually have it where it's like, although maybe not sign something, but at least we would know that this one person has already been addressed.
Eliminate some bias.
Yeah.
So, actually, I think that we probably do need little bit of committee approval here, but what we're proposing is that basically the group's actually going to split in two. It's like two separate projects.
Yeah, that's why I said I'm working with them on one thing and one another.
Oh, okay.
For that, for the concept of the survey and getting people's actual opinions on it. I'm still working with Walden Mayor's Court with Dick as well. But no, I'm just working on the history of that. I just got Dick's information, so.
So they'll do like a scientific sample of like, so that we'll actually be representative of Yellow Springs and do like quantitative sort of questions to get like a sense of people's feelings and stuff. I can't speak to it very much.
Overall view, but yeah.
Yeah. And then we're, our sample in terms of interviewing people narratively won't be scientific, won't be representative. I was thinking about just putting out a call through letters to the editor and Facebook posts. I have a draft of what that would be. Would you guys want like a complete draft taken to the committee and approved before we send anything to the newspaper, I imagine?
How would people feel about that?
I would be concerned no matter what it is, that it not be perceived badly. Not surprised, okay. And I'm, that's sort of a favorite right, putting it, but so. Just like you were saying.
So you have a draft.
Steve was saying.
So I'll bring an even better draft in December. How does that sound?
That's yes, okay.
Okay, that's
okay.
Yeah,
maybe. But yeah, we wanted to make sure that everyone was on board, that like, here's what we're doing and here's what we're going to be asking people to be involved in.
Yeah. Right,
so we definitely weren't going to go on our own.
Right, because we did say last time when we were using the term rabbit hole, be careful not to go down the rabbit hole, you know, meaning without some logic to it or some reason why you're doing it. So, yeah, proposal would be great, right?
And then, yeah, similarly, like a template of what are the questions we'll be asking. Mm-hmm. You guys want to see that too in December?
Yeah, right? Well, that's what I'm
saying.
Yeah.
Cool.
Did you have a meeting?
Judith, John, and Basim all had a meeting about the youth part of it. And what we kind of talked about is in January and then February, and then we'd be setting up the foundation now, is having Chief Hale or other police officers coming in not necessarily in a big assembly, but more one-on-one, so like in every person's English class, actually discuss their rights with police officers and within criminal justice. Because to have someone else tell you, it almost makes it feel like you should be afraid of them abusing your rights, but also not knowing your rights gives you the fear of it being abused. So having the actual police force come in and have one-on-one conversation with kids, what police officers are allowed and not allowed to do, I feel like would be beneficial overall.
That's a great idea.
Yes, that's a great idea.
We need to be careful that we, a group of young POC, had something like that. And it ended up being a lot more intimidating when it came across. Instead of him coming in and just wanting to talk, it was almost like, you must understand that we have to power in all these situations. And basically from the age of 10 on, we can, you know, interrogate you. It was like they were telling what they can do. And it was, it ended up being very frightening.
So it didn't focus on your rights. So
it was more like they would let it be really known that it's our discretion. And so of course we should have an ACLU coming and
I think maybe I've heard about this. I might suggest that someone and Judith and I accompany go to Patty Bates. Maybe you and Judith go to Patty Bates and tell her what you're just now saying. Because we do not want to send the chief out to the high school to have students be more intimidated. That's the opposite.
Yeah,
what he's doing. Exactly what that needs to get back.
He brought Officer Nat. I think if it were just him, it wouldn't have happened.
Oh, yes.
But
okay,
he ended up bringing
Nat. It depends on the officer.
And that was frightening to.
Yeah.
And he got like that.
Yeah. The opposite side of that was making sure that the kids weren't like, oh yeah, well we have all the power, because like, so there's a fine line, and just making sure that the environment in which it happens is good to start out with, so that it has the best possible outcome. So, yeah, we talked about that, that it could easily go wrong, but you have to do it the right way and make sure you've thought through everything.
I would suggest trying to make a dry run with a small group of people.
Right.
Because Dave is a cop, and he's not from around here, and he sounds like it. And he's got his way of delivery, and he's going to do that, and doing it more than
once. Don't want to bring another officer is all that advice. That was the only issue that actually happened. I've never seen it. It wasn't really him. It was that who was there, and he was almost showing off his status as a sergeant, and it was not.
It would be best to have someone that, like, most people in the community know as a police officer.
Yes.
And it's like kids, especially like our age and younger, that we would be talking to, or they would be talking to, probably don't have too many experiences with the police, so might not know them very well. But just more of a chance for them to know them would be good. Mm-hmm. Or just like establish that this is a person that lives in the community for this many years, and you know, just already makes it better.
I would suggest David Meister, because his daughter Jane goes to the
exactly.
school.
Yeah, he would be the perfect person to do this.
Right.
Right.
If you guys bring an officer, please tell them to bring Meister.
Someone that you know, and that is not, like, I don't want to like say that any police officer is necessarily threatening, but is as unthreatening as possible.
And another thing we discussed, and like, we didn't go very far into it, but is how police officers will treat certain minors differently than other minors, depending on how well they know their parents or how long they've been in the village. Because there are some kids I know who have lived there all their life and have been caught like drinking and driving and have been sent on their way, and they just call their parents and say, hey, your kid's on your way home. And there are other kids who it's a serious problem, and like it should be, and sent to court. Mm-hmm. But the unfair treatment of minors, because it's such a small town, needs to be addressed as well.
It sounds like your group's already done some really great thinking about this, so it sounds good.
We're so happy you're here. Volleyball and soccer are
now basketball season. We hear that often.
I think it's an ongoing thing. This would be really good, because the next wave of kids is going to come along and not have this experience.
Yeah.
But you would be here to do it for the next 20 years.
Right.
Someone mentioned the ACLU, bringing them in. I think that would be a great idea.
Yeah, that was our idea, to kind of combat the... Because like I said, they came in and they really laid the hammer down as to what rights you had. And so they were like, well, maybe we should actually bring in lawyers.
Right.
But then again, there's, well, it's like today.
Inspiring fear of the police officer by not having them.
I've been asked for my license at least 6 or 7 times as a passenger.
Yeah.
Like without, I've easily. And I combated it once, and my friend got mad at me. It was like, we're black. He can do whatever he wants. Like, they were more mad than I actually knew that I had. There was no right for them to do it.
Exactly.
They were more mad at me than the concept of, because the officer refused to not let me not to. It was like, I'm not operating a vehicle. You clearly pulled us over for a traffic thing.
Right.
That's why, you know. And my friend was getting more and more agitated with me. Because it's like, just get this done and over with. And it's like, I've had that experience numerous times. So to hear him say, no, that's not a thing, it's like, it is, though.
Yeah.
And they do it all the time. There's a reason we're asking you. So you can tell me what the books say, and then the judge can see her and also say, no.
Yeah.
Like, they really can't do that. They do, though. They do it a lot. They do it all the time. It's addressing that aspect of, I know you do it, so really, why are you doing it? Are we going to really address that issue?
That's it might be a good idea to have a conversation, not just with whoever the officer is, but also maybe with the students from a teacher that is liked. maybe not like necessarily the principal or the vice principal, but just a teacher to say, maybe Mr. Smith or something, to say like, hey, this is what's going to happen. Don't be defensive, but don't attack the police officer, because also like it's kind of on the police officer as well to not come in with that attitude,
right.
And because that attitude is just always going to be met with defensiveness on the other side. So if the kids are defensive, then the officer is going to get defensive, and if the officer is defensive, the kids will get defensive
very quickly. And then they'll start like throwing rude comments or snide remarks, and then it just won't go well at all. So just to have both sides be briefed on, like, just be chill. Yeah. Like, yeah, it's not a big deal. They're not going to come and, like, I don't know, bust you on the spot for something. Yeah. It's just, they're here.
So very good thinking. And David's idea is something to at least consider. Could you do a pilot, see how it works? And
right.
With some hand-picked
okay, we,
children.
Would it be... Would it be possible just to have Dave Meister go?
I don't know.
Why not? Yeah, we just invite him.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Clothes, I
mean. Not have like not even like two people,
right?
Like just one person, and then just talking like very nonchalantly, like
right,
calmly, and
the
just telling you,
that.
Just want to let you know, like this is what happens, and if you have any questions, feel free. Just very welcoming, so that like people don't
yeah
feel the need to get defensive and, you know, have a situation.
It might be good to have a specific, maybe you've already thought about this, but I don't know, have a specific set of questions to ask or a circumstance, like tell us about traffic stops,
yeah,
tell
yeah
us about
because
something else.
Most kids won't be worried about how they'll be represented in court. It will mostly be smaller offenses like traffic stops
drinking
or underage drinking.
Yeah.
Right. And yeah so I'm pretty sure most officers would comply with, okay, stick to the specific things that would only apply to teenagers. And also, I don't know, I haven't had in-depth conversations with Mr. Meister, but I do believe we should pick an officer who would be willing to discuss things like race or gender profiling
mm-hmm
when they do pull people over. And if the officer's not willing to discuss that, then we do need to find somewhere else.
He doesn't have to necessarily come in and talk about it, but if there are questions,
he's
not going to like shut down and not answer or work around them or anything. Just like face them and be as diplomatic, I guess, as possible with it. And the other thing is, didn't we talk about doing some kind of survey or something with people at our high school, wondering what they think the biggest problem with the police is or whatever. And then, I mean, I think without even doing the survey, I can guess the top three things that would be of interest. And then have the, like, bring that to the police officer and so that they know what they're, like, getting.
What
yeah
questions.
Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah, so you're prepping the police officer and then prepping the
right
service.
So that they all know what's happening well before it happens, and it's not like some kind of big shock or they're not, yeah.
Well, it could be that there's a misunderstanding on both sides.
Right,
you know.
Exactly.
Well, it sounds good, and as Jennifer said,
it's,
you probably have the right to just say, we want this guy, this is the guy we want. You know?
Right.
So, that's okay. And Jennifer, speaking of you.
Well, you know, it's not even a hard time getting together.
It's been a rough season.
Yeah, it's been a rough season. So,
okay,
more to come on restorative justice. And,
okay. Well, how about if we just, everybody says you have something a little more concrete, we'll all make an effort to have something a little more concrete to share on December 13th.
Sounds great.
Needed seven then. Any other issues or comments?
Could you give a brief definition or description of what you mean by restorative justice? Because I have the sense that it means more than
yeah
what I think it means.
Well, it's restorative justice focuses on healing relationships, basically. So it's sort of anathema to our legal system, where the victim and the offender are separated, they don't talk to each other, and somebody else decides what the punishment is and, you know, what the terms are. So in restorative justice, the victim and the offender get together along with all of the other people who've been affected by the action, and together as a group, they decide what harms were created and how to remedy those harms. So the philosophy of it is that we want to keep people in the community. We don't want to kick them out. We don't want to, you know, incarcerate them unless they're dangerous. So I see the mayor's court referring, like not even having people necessarily go through mayor's court to get to restorative justice, but, you know, if a kid in your situation with a flare
That would be perfect for restorative justice, because you could have the coach talk about how, you know, how it affected him. Mm-hmm. You could have the kids talk about why they did what they did, which is also a big question. It doesn't even matter in legal systems.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it's always enlightening. So for cases that are really about repairing relationships, which I think is what we want to do in a community, I think restorative justice is really the way to go.
Yeah, that makes sense. Thanks.
I talked about this in our meeting, but there was a restorative justice committee for the high school that could have worked with a restorative justice committee here. But it didn't really go anywhere. We went through a training, and it was like a hand group, hand-selected group of kids that were representative of different racial backgrounds and, you know, like, things like that. And we were, like, we went to a meeting and everything, a couple meetings, and we said where we wanted to go with it, and went through a small training day and everything. And then when we came back the next year, nothing happened with it, and it was Molly Malone and Lake Miller that were doing it, and Molly graduated and Lake got busy his senior year, and I think just there wasn't like a teacher that was heavily involved with it, so right. Nothing happened, but that could be restored.
So what's happening, actually, I had a kid in eighth grade, mm-hmm. and Mr. Knosman?
I have no idea who that is.
He's the social studies teacher.
Oh, the new one that plays
right.
McCoy.
Right.
Okay.
So he is doing a PBL on various aspects of the justice system. And he said that the last one is going to be restorative justice. And he was asking me and probably others to train some students so that this could get carried on through the high school and down to, you know, seventh grade. So I think there is that traction again. But the more you request it, the more.
Yeah, I mean, like, and I did go through that training, and I know the other members that did. And there was one issue. It was that because the kids were handpicked, that some people that weren't handpicked that, like, felt passionately about it were very upset. They're like,
yeah.
Well, because I'm not, like, a different member, I can't be picked for that. That's unfair. So it should be half, like, voluntary and
sure.
half, like, maybe people that are in it going up to people and be like, do you want to do this? Like,
yeah.
So just to make it more fair.
I would be very happy to do trainings.
Right. Yeah.
Okay, any other kinds of general questions, and not to get to restorative justice right now, unless you have something that you could talk to.
I was just going to say that with restorative justice, it only works for crimes where there's mens rea, right? Like, you can use it for
right.
drugs.
Right.
Like, you have to, it has to be someone that committed something in a criminal state of mind, with a guilty mind. Like, you couldn't be DUI, couldn't be driving under suspension,
oh.
couldn't be in possession of drugs,
right.
couldn't be selling drugs.
To people involved with other people.
Yeah.
Right? And it would have to be you committed something with the state
right.
of mind that you were committing a crime.
Well, yes, but in
we can learn more about
okay.
restorative
right.
justice.
Right.
It's getting a little late here to keep dig into any of the topics. But any questions about the general operational planning that we're doing, or what comes next? Everybody gets it that next month you have something to share, some level of a product to give to people out of your group.
Can I ask something? About
sure.
To help people wrap their minds around what restorative justice is. Well, actually, I wouldn't have to take time in a group. I could just email you a link to a couple good examples.
I'd like that.
Yeah, it is really cool stuff.
Yeah, we can be emailing, well, I forget what the public, the whole thing about.
We just can't respond back to it.
Sorry?
We can send something to everybody, and we just can't all respond back to it.
I see, okay. You could send it, you just can't have everybody respond.
Even if it's just about a movie?
Mm-hmm. We can
can't have a group conversation.
Can't have
correct.
A group conversation.
Yeah.
But you can
it, yeah.
send information out.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah. We'll let you know.
Have we approved our minutes?
I like that.
Four
people.
We didn't.
It's like, okay, you have something to say, don't say it already.
Right.
Can we go to approve the minutes?
Can we approve our minutes from the last meeting? Actually, we approve.
This is silly. Yes, we.
You so moved.
I'm sorry.
Does anybody second this move?
I second it.
But this is something else we should do next when Ellis is here, and I think somebody else isn't here. Steve?
Lessie.
Lessie.
And Katie.
Yeah. We haven't really talked about our process. I've just jumped in with stuff, but I don't have any consensus that how we're going to do this or what we should do. So we do a little bit of that, our guidelines or agreements next month.
And whoever took the minutes should send them to Judy Kintner.
Okay.
That's what some notes you think some notes is on.
Today?
Yeah.
Not for public disclosure.
Well, that's what this is for.
Thanks to everybody for making progress.
Yeah.